Hi guys, it's great to be here. I'm very happy. Thank you, Market One, for inviting me. Always happy to exchange ideas with people interested in marketplaces. I've been in your shoes in the past. You can tell I'm from Greece by my name. So it doesn't show, but I actually started quite a few years back. As an entrepreneur, I was involved in an e-tailer first. I launched, together with two friends, an e-commerce company, and then the food marketplace, which we happily sold to Delivery Hero in 2015. And then I was very involved with a doctor-patient marketplace and with Beat, which is now in Greece and Latin America, and was sold to Daimler. Beat is like a mobility service like Uber. Gradually, I became an angel investor. So I started investing in many startups in Europe and in the US in an effort to interact with different cultures, to learn from other entrepreneurs, to benchmark myself and also all the other founders in Greece. And actually in 2015, together with a friend, we launched Venture Friends. This is where we are now. It's an interesting story. We started just George, me, and Stefanos, our first associate, who after just 2 years left and did his own startup. So either we worked too hard, so he decided to leave and become an entrepreneur, or we really inspired him to become an entrepreneur. Now we're four people, Pavlos, Yorgos, me, and George. We're happy to have launched our second fund last year with the support of EIF, which is a 50 million fund. Our first fund was 20 million. It was the first private-only fund in Greece. We've been quite busy, so we've done, I mean, I don't know, we're spontaneous. It's like entrepreneurs, you know, you just cannot stop pulling the trigger. So we did 13 investments in 3.5 years. Obviously, not all of them successful, but we managed to get it right sometimes. We love consumer. We like marketplaces a lot. And we started investing in Greek founders, but eventually we soon realized we want to be a European fund and started investing in all around Europe. In terms of marketplace experience, I mean, it took me some time to realize that it's a busy slide because we have invested in all kinds of verticals in marketplaces. So we have experience in travel vertical through Welcome Pickups, which is an airport pickup service, and Stasher. Mobility through Spotterwheel, which is actually active in Poland, Flexcar and Beat, real estate through Blueground, Spotahome, Homemade, generally professional services like doctors, nannies, home services, food, obviously, if the food delivery, but also groceries, which is another very interesting space. Even we tipped our toes on B2B with PackHelp, a great Polish company, and Nerks in the US. So having said that, I mean, I know this doesn't remind marketplaces, but I like the picture, and I like the bridge. I mean, the bridge is the only thing that can allude to a marketplace because it connects large number of suppliers on the one side with large number of demand in the other side. So this is what marketplace is. It's clear to everybody. So let me share some thoughts around the supply side to begin with, then the demand side, and then some general thoughts. So on the supply side, I mean, typically, we all know about it. It's a chicken and egg. You have to build supply first. And you can build it by call center or by in-person visits. You can use digital marketing. But one thing you need to keep in mind is that not all supply is equal, actually. So in the beginning, especially when you're launching a new service that the consumer is not used to it, it's important to think whether you can add to the credibility of your service by partnering, by working with supply-side partners that are recognizable. So, for instance, for Delivery Hero, imagine, I mean, you're the first time visiting this landing page. If they work with Burger King or Pizza Hut, that helps you, right? That increases conversion rate. This is extremely important in our company like Stasher, where we ask you to trust your luggage to this place in London that you've never heard of. How much more comfortable would you be if that place was a hotel? So that's what the founders, I mean, thought about adding reputable places where you can store your luggage. That's an idea for you to think when you're building your marketplace. Even reputable supply can help you increase conversion and drive adoption more quickly. And then the other thing that is not obvious is that, I mean, we did a mistake a few times as founder and as investors. We're just adding supply, and then we said, okay, now that we have added a lot of supply, let's bring in the demand. I mean, typically the demand doesn't come quickly. It grows naturally. So if you have added some, you have spent your money in adding some suppliers, and then they don't get enough demand, they lose, they're not engaged anymore. And I think a very important example is Airbnb. Airbnb in the beginning, they were spending so much to convince people to give their houses, to become hosts. And then they were adding supply. If that host would not get a booking for a few months, then they would lose interest, they would become less responsive, and that eventually hurt the marketplace. So one lesson here is sometimes you need to scale supply, have demand follow, and then continue scaling supply on parallel. So this is some ideas on the supply. And then on the demand side, obviously, typically in a marketplace, the hardest part is how to build demand. You're trying to educate the market. It's becoming more and more expensive, as we know. But before thinking about the demand channels, we should never forget that product comes first. And product is not just a UI that we typically think of when discussing about product. Imagine Uber having an amazing UI, or Tier having an amazing UI, and then you go and you search for a driver, and the closest driver is 10 minutes away. So this is part of the product. This is part of the experience. There is marketing spending money on the product, and then you don't have a good experience for the customer, so that goes to waste. In some marketplaces that are more high touch, for instance, if you're home services, cleaning, or selling a used car, there will be more than one touch points with the customer. So a good customer service is also part of the product. You need to be there. You need to be responsive. So assuming you have solved your product and you're very happy with it and you're ready to boost and do marketing, then you have to identify what's the best channel for you. So if you are, is it the coupons, referrals, or search? For most products, search is very relevant. Do you need to use an aggregator? Are you a power host and then Airbnb is your demand channel? Or can you think of partnerships? And I'll talk about that because for that is key for me. So if you are a service, and of course, high frequency services are the most interesting ones because they have a lifetime value over time, that builds over time, which actually gives you an incentive to overpay in the beginning because you know you will make up that acquisition cost later, then you should induce trial. That's why you see Uber offering coupons. Tier is doing the same. They try to get you in this habit loop where you're going to try the service and then you're going to stick with it. So they're happy to pay a bit more in the beginning. So that's when it's a high-frequency product. In most cases, SEO is very important. And I have an example of Dog Planner, like this great Polish success. I was checking Alexa. They have like 8 million users visiting every month. 77% is search. And 75 is actually organic. Imagine having 6 million visitors per month without having to pay for it. So SEO is very important when there are many searches, when the search universe is big. But actually, even in cases where you wouldn't expect people to search for luggage storage, nobody knows that they can store their luggage when they have to leave their Airbnb. So that's not a reason why not to invest in SEO, because what we've seen with Stasher is that within 3 years, the volume of searches has quadrupled. So you need to build your SEO on-site, link building. You need to think of that in advance so that you're in the right position and tap on that search universe when it becomes bigger. So SEO is still relevant. If you are in the real estate, you are a broker or you are operating furnished apartments like Blue Ground or selling used cars, then you have to work with listing sites. And there, you have to optimize and think how you can gain more visibility compared to competition. So, of course, your listing has to be amazing. You have to update it frequently in order to stay longer on the first page. And you have to have a good response time in order to become by the so that the platform acknowledges you as a good user. This is a very important element that most people I don't think about. I mean, everybody thinks, okay, we're going to spend on Google. We will do the SEO. I think most entrepreneurs understand about the value of SEO. Some people don't think about how they can find partners. We need to think if we're solving a problem for somebody, and that somebody is willing to share, is willing to share that revenue, our revenue, so that they give us traffic. So in the case of welcome pickups, I mean, when you book your hotel, you will need. It's a natural thing to also book your pickup from the airport. We have very high conversion rates. And the hotel is actually providing a service that is relevant to the customer, and they solve a problem for them. So, and they also make some revenue. So this channel is amazing for welcome pickups. And for Stasher, on the same note, if you're a property manager, your customer leaves your Airbnb place, they ask you, okay, where can I leave my luggage? You cannot tell them anything. I mean, now you can tell them, go to Stasher, and you make some revenue, and you help your customer. The reason that those partnerships are important is not just because it's another channel, so it differentiates your demand generation, and it lowers your cost because it's affiliate-based. You do a revenue share, so you only pay when you're actually getting customer. But it's also a way to defend against competition. Your competitor cannot go to the same property manager or to the same hotel and strike a deal. It's very difficult. I mean, this is a process that takes time. You have to convince them, you have to make an integration, and then your competition cannot open that door. So that's important, I've seen. And it's actually significant for those companies, it's like more than 25% of their demand generation. So coming to some general points, I think this we discuss. Everybody has touched upon it. I mean, it's the network effects we discuss. So obviously, you have more demand. That means you can support more supply, and then you can bring more demand because of that. And the leadership position brings network effects because more suppliers as well as customers, they want to go where there is more liquidity. I think this is clear. What is interesting, and we've seen it has, we have touched upon it. I mean, I heard all the very interesting speeches before, and everybody discussed about how the marketplaces are gradually moving towards e-commerce, in essence. The first example is like if you're a home services. In most companies globally, like Home Advisor, Thumbtack, Star of Service, they typically stop when they provide a lead, a few leads to the customer. So the customer wants a plumber. We have a vetted database, and we tell them, okay, those three guys can do the job for you. But in essence, we realized that this created very high churn for the professionals because the professionals are forced to pay without getting the job. I mean, if we provide three leads to a customer, two of those leads are not going to get the job, and they will have paid for it. So at some point, there is a ceiling to this. Therefore, the only reason to solve the problem of dissatisfaction from the supply side and the customer side is to go closer to the transaction. So get paid on the after the job is done. This improves retention for the professionals, but it makes also the customer more happy because the professional is more engaged. The epitome of going full stack is like, it was discussed by Marcin as well in the beginning about how Airbnb is now building hotels in essence. And that's why we see companies like Sonder, which is actually in the short-term space, doing the same thing. They are actually renting apartments and are responsible for the whole experience of the whole customer experience. And Blueground, which is one of our portfolio companies, which is doing the same for the medium term. I think one needs to ask, is there a way for me to offer a better experience for my customer? And how will that experience improve? How much will it improve if I become, from a marketplace, a full-stack player? And if the difference is like significant, I think it's a hard job. It's much harder to be a full-stack player, but if you don't do it, somebody else will. The same example we saw with Spotterwheel, I mean, the B2C used car player. I mean, in the beginning, we said, okay, we're going to be peer-to-peer. The owner will give us the car, and we will sell it to another buyer. But because of the sales cycle that is 30 days, after 30 days, maybe the seller was not interested. Maybe he has changed his mind. There were delays. So the whole experience for the customer was actually subpar. So in essence, we were forced to become an e-tailer. We were forced to buy the car, inspect the car, buy the car, guarantee its state, and then sell it ourselves. So I hope I didn't say too many points. And the good thing is you're going to get a presentation so you can reflect and see the points in more detail. But just as a summary, obviously we start with supply, but think about prioritizing what kind of supply you add. Not all supply is equal. Grow supply in parallel with demand in order to retain the supply partners engaged while you grow. Think whether your product is fantastic before you invest in marketing. Identify what are the key demand channels for you. If you're a lucky service with a high frequency, induce the buyer, the customer, to try the service in order for him to create this habit. Optimize presence in listing sites if you are a relevant business where you have to list there to get demand. SEO is always relevant. SEO is not going to die, obviously. People will still search for their needs. Look for specific channels where you're adding value and those guys are happy to be paid on an affiliate basis in order to drive defensibility and differentiation in how you drive demand. High-frequency services, obviously, is better because you build a habit and you need less marketing. And finally, evaluate whether you should go closer to the transaction or even go full stack if needed. Because if you don't do it, somebody else will. With that, I want to thank you because this is the last speech. And I wish you the best of success with whatever you want to undertake. Thank you.